Good afternoon. My name is Joe Fitzgerald. I'm with the Center for Biosecurity. We're getting ready to start our final panel. By way of background, I'm a health physicist and public health professional, and have spent probably too many years at agencies like EPA, DOE, Department of Energy, and NIOSH, and have a fairly lengthy background in nuclear safety and radiation protection. The topic today, which is, again, lessons learned, and you'll hear me qualify that comment, as did the previous speakers. Obviously, these lessons are emerging at this point. But this particular topic has a lot of salience for me. I have to go back a bit in ancient history, not as far back as Dr. Denton, but after Chernobyl, the Chernobyl accident occurred, I was responsible at the Department of Energy for following up on the lessons from Chernobyl. And the first question that came out of the White House was, do we have any graphite reactors in this country? And they quickly looked around and established, yes, we had exactly one graphite reactor, Chernobyl being a graphite reactor that exploded and caught on fire. And that reactor was at the Hanford Reservation. It was a DOE reactor. So you can only imagine the fun that came from all that, because we spent several years not only going over the Chernobyl lessons learned, but also explaining why the Department of Energy's nuclear safety oversight program seemed to be radically different than that of the NRC's regulated program. And I can only tell you that the Chernobyl event stimulated the kind of oversight that led to the DOE having, I think, a succession of oversight boards leading to what is now the Defense Nuclear Facility Safety Board. So it's interesting how these things happen, but that was certainly a very memorable time for me. Let me first say that on this panel, I think Tom said earlier, we're not going to dwell on the adequacy of safety margins, you know, what about spent fuel, you know, nuclear power as an energy source. That's already, as you know, being hotly debated and will be certainly a national dialogue for some years. And I heard 5 years mentioned, and that's not a, you know, a bad estimate. It's, you know, it's certainly going to take several years to go through these lessons and figure out what they mean. So our primary context is quite apart from those issues. What does Fukushima tell us about the consequences of major radiation release? After every major nuclear accident, you certainly hear about the lessons learned in this whole process. And I think Commissioner Ossendorf spent a great deal of time walking through the rigor the NRC is indicating for its review. But you go through this lessons learned, this particular review. For Three Mile Island, you know, you heard Harold Denton talk about the need to go beyond risk assessments to consider how humans, in this case it was a human error that contributed to the accident at Three Mile Island, to go beyond the engineering to how operators play into the safety. And he emphasized the need for training. So a big lesson learned coming out of the Three Mile Island accident was the fact that human factors was a critical part, and you had to spend time dealing with training and the things that went to the qualifications and skills of your operators. It wasn't enough to look at the engineering of a reactor. For Chernobyl, I think it was the realization that you could have catastrophic radioactive releases from a nuclear power plant. And I think it reaffirmed, you know, what needed to be attended to when you in fact had a catastrophic release, that you had to look at prompt considerations, whether it's the children, the food chain, all those issues came to the fore. We knew that in principle. I think what Chernobyl taught us in terms of lessons is how critical, from a time standpoint, a lot of those considerations are. And I think a lot of what we talked about this morning was how critical certain steps are in terms of preparing and responding, having a pre-plan when you have a nuclear detonation. These are very much similar issues in terms of what kinds of actions are going to protect the public if you have a major release, and that certainly was a take-home from Chernobyl. For Fukushima, and I think some of these were touched on, clearly there's going to be a lot of inquiry on the implications of natural disasters, you know, how they in fact pose a compounding issue, a common mode failure issue, how they might impact some of the assumptions that go into some of these safety systems. Certainly the robustness of the severe action response, and I was glad to hear them focus in on the public emergency preparedness, and we're certainly going to follow very closely the dialogue that actually predated Fukushima, as he pointed out, this dialogue on what makes sense for a framework of emergency response for commercial nuclear power plants. This revision to that fundamental rule is up before the commission for review as it stands. But beyond all that, you know, I think Fukushima stands apart from these other accidents as a unique nuclear event, something that really is a different nuclear event. Like Three Mile Island, Fukushima involved a U.S. reactor design, one of our BWR designs, in a technologically advanced nation, very much same circumstances with TMI. But unlike TMI, Fukushima has resulted in a major radiological release. It certainly wasn't 100 millirem, which is what Dr. Denton talked about. A major radiological release and extended public evacuation. Like Chernobyl, the land around Fukushima has become contaminated with a radioiodine and cesium-137. And cesium-137 has a half-life of 30 years, so that's pretty substantial. But unlike Chernobyl, the Japanese did take prompt actions that really mitigated a lot of the public radiation exposure that would have occurred otherwise. So that certainly was a major distinction with Chernobyl. However, unlike either of these past two accidents, with Fukushima, you had something that was unexpected in a sense. It was a confluence, I'm going to use the word underappreciated, because certainly we knew about tsunamis, we knew about earthquakes, and certainly plants have seismic standards in terms of robustness, but it was underappreciated what the magnitude of the phenomena might be. I think that was explained very well by Commissioner Ossendorf, and what the implications would be for all these safeguards that were built into the plant and all these procedures. I think before that, Dr. Denton pointed out, you know, if you can't keep the AC power on, it doesn't matter how good your procedures are or how good your operators are trained, you're done. And I think that's a very chilling perspective. I guess one could ask why in an advanced society does it take an accident or near miss to stimulate this revisiting, this new thinking? You know, why are we all talking about commercial nuclear power? Yes, there's an accident, but why are we all talking about it? And I actually thought the current NRC chairman, Jasko, answered that question in a pretty good way. And this is a quote, and this was before, I think there's some people from AAAS here, this is before the AAAS about a week ago. All of these events have served to transform in fairly fundamental ways how we understand the nature of nuclear safety and security and what we need to do ultimately to protect the public. And he went on further that it is important that the methods of science, including an opening and questioning attitude, inform public policy. I mean, I think that lays it all out. I mean, I think in these kinds of times, you have to open the book, you have to put away some of the premises and some of the presumptions, and you have to look at your systems anew. You have to look at your plans and procedures. You got to look at what worked, what didn't in Japan. and you have to sort of hold that up to public scrutiny and be able to answer those questions. And that's pretty much what I had heard, but certainly that's the process. Safety, like I think public health for biological threats, nuclear safety for accidents, they're learning disciplines. And accidents events give you the opportunity to in fact, advance the science. So this is a positive thing. And I want to add that with, you know, we had a lot of statistics, but let me add one more. With 435 active nuclear reactors in service globally, if you add the 250 that are under construction or ordered, I think there's many who have postulated that, you know, we're likely, whether it's an intentional incident or an accident, likely to see a major release almost on a generational level, 10 to 20 years. And that's a major change in the mindset. I mean, I grew up in the nuclear industry, and sort of studied through it and everything, and certainly the sense it was a very improbable event. You didn't think about any periodicity of having to deal with a major commercial nuclear power accident. But I think that question is a bit more plausible right now. I think there's going to be many, the NRC, the utilities, individuals like yourself that will be scrutinizing this and asking that question as to, you know, is there any way to make this process better? On that note, what we're doing at the Center for Biosecurity is investigating and asking questions related to the Fukushima accident and contrasting that with how business is done here. We're not second-guessing, certainly, the process that Commissioner Ostendorf talked about, but what we're trying to do is begin to ask questions outside defense. In the context of emergency preparedness, public health preparedness, many of the subjects we talked about today, and to hold perhaps these frameworks, these premises up into the light, see how the emerging lessons from Fukushima inform that process and come to some kind of conclusion. So we are starting certainly that inquiry today. Some of the questions we want to deal with, and these I think were mentioned by Tom in his opening remarks, are first, whether the U.S. public is adequately prepared for similar radiation emergencies, and whether the current emergency planning zones and protective action guidelines, the PAGs that were referred to, are sufficient for our needs. And as Japanese authorities relax both occupational and public exposure standards, as they have been doing, certainly, you might have heard about the issue with school children and the controversy surrounding that. Whether we nationally and maybe even internationally need to reconsider the role that radiation standards, the standards that we apply to situations both routine and from an emergency standpoint, whether we need to reconsider how they are used when you're in that emergency situation. And in the recovery situation. I think this kind of raises questions about how we apply those standards and whether it makes sense to apply what I would call your routine standards in an emergency circumstance. Is there a new normal that you need to consider when you apply standards? I think that's the question we're asking. Likewise, at a time when early surveys show two-thirds of the Japanese public do not trust official reports on Fukushima, whether and how we can do a better job of communicating radiation information and making this process more transparent. I think this notion of trust, and we've touched on that on several occasions, is a very critical issue relative to not only nuclear, but also questions of radioactive releases and radiation in general. And I have to tell you, having been in the profession my entire career, I just don't think, you know, we have improved that very much. I sense that we still have that issue surrounding us, and that it's very vexing. Even the units, I have to admit, I was trained on REM and have to do the back calculation of sieverts every time we go through this, but it's a source of confusion, and it just seems like we can do a better job in light of this. Given the psychosocial stresses related to radiation releases, I guess another question is whether communities can become sufficiently resilient, subject to the conference, to respond and recover not only from INDs but from these kinds of accidents. And I think that's something that I hope Mike Gresalfi will address when he talks. Whether we need to take another look at needing capabilities and capacities of healthcare providers and first responders. And I think Steve Becker is going to address that as well. And finally, with 80,000 evacuees to be dealt with in Japan, they're currently in evacuation camps, whether it is feasible to make practical and acceptable resettlement and recovery decisions when you have radiation contamination involved. I think there's going to be some very, very tough policy decisions that will have to be made in Japan in real time and a real issue that perhaps haven't been made in this country and in the first world. And certainly I don't know if Chernobyl is a good template for that. And finally, my caveat. We're approaching this topic cautiously at this early time. You know, as has been said by just about every speaker, we don't have all the facts or even a lot of the facts and lessons from Japan, but we certainly have a sense of where the issues may be. And I'm going to draw a distinction. This morning, everybody was addressing INDs and the impacts on the public respecting nuclear detonations. I think the distinction between what we're talking about this afternoon and what we talked about this morning, perhaps, is the fact that for INDs, we're looking to develop a framework for response. You know, there's not really a very good framework, I think that was pointed out in the first talk this morning by Brooke, a very good framework to work through. With commercial nuclear, we have decades of refined regulatory framework, a lot of debate, a lot of lessons learned have already been cranked in. So this is a case of taking an established framework and seeing whether or not from an implementation standpoint with an actual accident on the ground, whether that framework worked as planned or not. I think that's the biggest distinction I can draw between the two discussion topics that you've heard today. And with that, I want to introduce our panel. To my left, and this we are really fortunate to have the speakers that we do have. I've heard many people say that we just don't know what's happening in Japan. Actually, we strove to find people who can speak firsthand what's happening in Japan. And to my left, Dr. Yoshikura Haraguchi is a recently retired department head and emergency medicine physician at the National Hospital, let's see if I get this right, National Hospital Tokyo Disaster Medical Center. In Japan, and he is also currently a representative of the Japanese Compendium of Disaster Medicine and Medicine Against NBC Hazards, which is an NGO. And he has been actively providing since March. He retired in March, which I asked him last night if that was good timing or not, but he retired in March and is now actively supporting certainly the government and other NGOs in terms of his expert advice. Seated next to him is Iyasu, to my immediate left, Iyasu Nagata, and he's going to help on the translation on some of the questions if need be. I appreciate his willingness to do that. On Dr. Haraguchi's left is Dr. Steve Becker, associate professor at the University of Alabama. He is a leading expert on the community response, psychosocial, and risk communication issues associated with emerging health threats. He has done extensive research and analysis in public health preparedness for radiation terrorist threats. And most excitedly, he has just returned from being in Japan for 10 days, this is about a week or two ago, actually providing training and support for Japanese first responders, medical and public health practitioners involving radiation monitoring and screening of the public near Fukushima. So. We're excited that we have a first person to count on that. To Steve's left is Dr. Scott Deitchman. He's the Associate Director for Terrorism Preparedness and Emergency Response at the Center of Communicable Disease for Communicable Disease and Prevention, CDC. He has led CDC's response to what seems to be a long list of global disasters. You and Thad Allen seem to have the same list. But anyway, a number of global disasters, including the 2004-2005 Asian tsunami disaster, the various hurricane landfalls in 2004 to 2008, and the 2010 Deepwater Horizon oil spill, and that's just an abbreviated list. He has been actively following the Fukushima disaster as well on the behalf of CDC, so we're definitely interested in your firsthand perspectives of what the domestic picture looked like as you were following Fukushima. And finally, Dr. Michael Gresalfi, at the far end, is the Senior Advisor for CBRNE, Chemical, Biological, Radiological, Nuclear Explosive, that sector, as well as the Whole Community Initiative in FEMA's Response Directorate. From his extensive work on nuclear and radiological threats, he has broad expertise and experience with communications, evacuation, zoning, and community resilience issues, and we're very interested in your perspective on how your work with the Whole Community Initiative might help with the Fukushima preparedness and recovery as well. Okay, with that, I'd like to invite Dr. Haraguchi to, we're going to go ahead and make some short presentations, about 5 to 10 minutes apiece. And Dr. Haraguchi, you have the floor.
Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, the Tohoku earthquake and nuclear disaster is presented briefly. Large number of victims were caused. First, I would like to show the destroyed houses by tsunami, and left and right side is fire. And next, Japanese government doing their best. Prime Minister's concept is towards a society of minimal misfortune, he said 2 years ago. And I would like to speak a little about the philosophy, utilitarianism, the greatest good for the greatest number of people is the most famous concept for disaster medicine. As you know, Bentham and Mill are famous. On the contrary, there is a different concept of John Rawls. Maybe you know. I will return to the tsunami. This is Fukushima Daiichi nuclear station. That area was destroyed. And this map shows, on the left side, shows the very contaminated area after the nuclear plant destroy. On the right side, you can see the tsunami attack to the nuclear station. Japanese government decided to three kinds of control. First, not permitted area. Second is a evacuation ready area. Third, eventual evacuation area. It is shown here. Red area was not permitted to enter. And purple color is a eventually evacuation sorry, evacuation ready area. And yellow area is eventually evacuation area. And so many people are under this restriction. And this is a medical hospital. Medical care was done with PPE, personal protective equipment. So difficult to perform smooth medicine. Please, I supported this area, which shown in the arrow. Yellow arrowhead means the place of this area. Very strict control was done. And other area, there is a high radioactivity data, maybe more than 30 or 40 times than the usual value. However, medical support is very important, necessary. This is a picture in the primary school. As you see, a nurse checking the boy. And on the left side, you can see the aged man and small children, small children here. So medical care is very difficult sometimes. This is a medical system for contaminated people in a hospital, about 100 kilometers from the destroyed plant. Human counter or whole body counter is prepared. And basically, our concept is that aim of disaster medicine is to recover from the destroyed, exhausted society to the normal condition as soon as possible. And I would like to show some other experience. Of course, you know, this is a Chernobyl. Contaminated ground is a very big problem. And also, thyroid cancer was a very big problem. This is earthquakes caused, destroyed Kariwa nuclear station, just a little. However, one year it was stopped. And medical system were basically good, but the number of the patients can only a few patients can be treated at the same time. JCO plants, criticality, famous criticality problem. As you see. And this, no radioactivity or leakage was found, but the rupture of a secondary water pipe in Mihama nuclear plant killed 5 people and 6 injured. also special care for the weak people is also important, as you say. Basically, earthquake cause any kinds of disaster, and nuclear disaster was also caused. And I'm afraid that in our country, the condition may be in the malignant cycle, which means and the major disaster caused many, many big problems and so-called malignant cycle. There is a risk of malignant cycle. And we should interrupt the malignant cycle. Several factors will be important, especially communication system rely based on the reliability should be established. And SMILE, this is also our aim. In near future, we would like to enjoy a SMILE. That's all. Thank you very much.
You want to stay there?
No, I'll go up. Slides.
He's waiting back here. I think that's a good sign.
Oh, there we go. Good afternoon, everyone. I will be talking to you very briefly about a radiological emergency assistance mission that I had the privilege to be part of that was invited to Japan to assist hospitals, healthcare professionals, and first responders in dealing with the situation caused by the accident at Fukushima Daiichi nuclear facility. The earthquake that hit off the east coast of Japan on March 11th, 2011, you heard earlier, was absolutely staggering in its impact. You heard that it was one of the five largest earthquakes ever recorded, but you may not know that it was so powerful that it actually moved the landmass of Japan. Furthermore, it actually lowered the coastal areas of the country a significant amount, so that as you walk through some of the coastal communities, you can actually see infrastructure that still remains, like fire hydrants, up in the air because the rest of the land has sunk. Thus, when the tsunami that occurred shortly after the earthquake hit, it had an even easier time overwhelming the coastal defenses. It overwhelmed coastal defenses for port areas, for residential communities, for villages, for farmland. Many of us heard about the impacts in Sendai, but in fact, this was a little bit like the Katrina situation, which is media attention tended to focus on one place or a couple of places, but in fact, there were impacts up and down the coast. And indeed, it was well over 100 miles of coast in Japan that were affected by the earthquake, by the tsunami. You heard that the tsunami was about 40 feet high, but in fact, in some places, it was much higher than that, because when it was channeled by buildings or went up stream beds, the height rose, the speed increased. As a result, it wreaked havoc not just on the coastline, but a good number of miles inland as well. This is a picture I think you'll probably recognize, or at least you've seen photos like this. 90% of the fishing fleet was destroyed and carried inland, so that miles away from the coast, In many, many areas, what you will see are fishing boats, large ships scattered among the damaged buildings and other infrastructure. And you will also see large pools of water that have remained in the area. Something on the order of 125,000 buildings were destroyed, and 25 million tons of rubble were created. Right now, the best estimate is that working at full speed with tens of thousands of people on the job, it's still going to take 3 years or more just to control the rubble that was left by this disaster. Approximately 15,000 people have been confirmed to have been killed, and there are wide areas of Japan, at least in the affected prefectures, where if you turn your head as far to the right as it will go and scan across the horizon as far to the left as your head will go, this is all you see. And that includes not just areas that were farmland, but actual residential areas where homes used to be. I might add, and this is relevant to us, that one of the many factors that contributed to the death toll was the fact that there were traffic jams. Large numbers of traffic jams after the tsunami warnings were sounded, so that even though instructions had been issued and people had practiced not evacuating in that manner, in fact, when push came to shove, there were large traffic jams and people found themselves stuck, unable to move, and were swamped by the water and killed. There are also, I think you heard, the latest count right now is somewhere between 9 and 10,000 people still missing. This is a photograph that I took inside an evacuation center. It actually reminds me of the kinds of things I saw at Ground Zero in New York after 9/11, where families have put up notices, pictures of loved ones in the unfortunately usually vain hope of finding them. So this is very much a continuing disaster for those families. It's also a continuing disaster not just because of the radiological emergency at Fukushima Daiichi, but also, should I stand back a little? Am I echoing? Oh, okay. I can hear myself. But also because, and this, as the story has dropped out of the news, this fact has been forgotten. There are aftershocks every day. When we were there, there was not a day that went by without an aftershock, and some of them were pretty hefty. We were getting 6.0s, 6.2s. Scientists tell us that there is a very high probability that sometime over the next 4 years, there will be even bigger aftershocks and earthquakes that could hit magnitude 8.0. That is in the territory that could again cause a very damaging earthquake, as well as a tsunami. So this is not just a disaster that has occurred, it is very much a disaster that continues to unfold. I won't say much about the actual plant itself because that has been very capably covered, except to say that it was swamped by the tsunami. That's a picture of the entrance to the 20-kilometer exclusion zone. And there are still tens of thousands of people living in shelters. And one of the things that became clear from this was that because of the wide damage, many places that had been designated as shelters in the event of a variety of different kinds of disaster scenarios became unavailable. So there was actually and continues to be a tremendous shortage of shelter space. And as a result, you see this picture. This was taken weeks after the emergency began, and there are still many families who are living in cardboard boxes inside of sports facilities. The areas are clean, hygiene is excellent, but nevertheless, you can imagine how difficult it is for a family to live in such a small space with very little privacy. To tell you something about our mission, and I think I probably have to move fairly quickly here. Shortly after the disaster occurred, the Tokushukai Medical Group, which operates 68 hospitals in Japan, and its nonprofit disaster relief organization known as TMAT, issued an urgent appeal to a sister organization in the United States, New York City Medics. New York City Medics, as you can see from the slide, is an international disaster relief organization. It specializes in very rapidly deploying teams, including to areas that are hard to reach. And what Tokushukai Group and TMAT asked on an urgent basis was for assistance for their healthcare personnel, their hospitals, as well as first responders in understanding how they should handle the current situation. And in particular, what they requested was training from a specialized team in the US. It was decided, based on the kinds of issues that had been raised and the kinds of questions that had been identified by TMAT and Tokushukai, that an integrated approach was best. That is to say, their questions not only dealt with radiological issues and personal protective equipment and contamination issues, but also medical management, mental health issues, psychological effects, as well as communication concerns. And so it was agreed that an integrated team would be assembled. And three people were invited to go. Dr. Andy Karam, who is Director of Radiological Operations for the New York City Department of Health and Mental Hygiene. However, he went as a private individual. He was tasked with covering radiological issues. Dr. Kate Uranek, who is Senior Medical Officer for the Healthcare Emergency Preparedness Program for the New York City Health Department. She was tasked with covering medical issues. Again, she went as a private individual and not as a representative of her agency. And then I was tasked with covering psychosocial and risk communication issues. And in my case, I was going actually officially from the University of Alabama at Birmingham. These are the things that we did in the 10 days that we were on the ground. We did a rapid assessment of the tsunami-affected areas as well as the areas affected by the nuclear accident. We met with hospital officials in a variety of locations, local mayors, the Tokyo Metropolitan Government, representatives of the central government. We went to a number of evacuation centers to look at not only how they were set up and operating, but also how medical care was being provided. We also had the opportunity to observe radiation radiological screening that was being conducted. In the end, we gave 6 trainings at hospitals in various locations in Japan, primarily, as I said, to doctors, nurses, first responders, dentists who were involved in forensic work, identifying the bodies of the dead. And ultimately, we gave trainings to approximately 1,100 people over the 10-day period. So, we have identified approximately 40 lessons learned from this mission, many of them with direct relevance, I think, to preparedness and response for an IND event, for a large-scale radiological terrorism event, or indeed for any kind of large-scale incident involving radioactive materials. Time does not, alas, permit me to cover very many of them. Otherwise, a large hook will come across the stage and you will see me pulled off of here. So I'm just going to very quickly highlight 5 and leave them with you to think about. Lesson number 1, when one of these events occurs, there is a major need for radiological training. Major need for radiological training of healthcare professionals, public health personnel, and first responders. Ah, you say, but people have already had training. But I think as the NRC commissioner so aptly pointed out, there's a big difference between a drill and practicing and taking a course or a CME course and suddenly finding yourself in the midst of a calamity. And indeed, that was made very clear to us. Even people, even healthcare professionals who had had training before, really felt a powerful need to revisit the issues, to relearn and recover some of the material about how you protect yourself, how you deal with contamination. Furthermore, and I think one of the other speakers very rightly pointed this out, it is not just doctors and nurses who work in hospitals. There are all sorts of personnel, support personnel, housekeeping, and they have had no training, generally speaking, on these issues. They want to know, and they need that training if they're going to be expected to continue doing their jobs. I will tell you that the integrated approach that we utilized was very well received in Japan, and I believe it may serve as a model for future assistance operations of this type, because the kinds of challenges that were faced by hospitals, healthcare professionals, and others ran the gamut from how do you handle a contaminated, injured person, all the way to what are the groups that are at greatest risk for psychiatric impacts. So that's lesson number one. Lesson number two, which really flows from the first point, is there is a huge need for information and informational materials in hospitals. We found that when newly arriving patients get there, they want to know about their status in terms of radioactive contamination. They want to know about health issues. Patients already at the hospitals have their concerns about what it means to have potentially contaminated people arriving at the hospital. They need information. Staff, as I mentioned, needs information. Families of staff need information. In some cases, this is general information. In other cases, it involves what the actual readings are and what they mean in terms of the people who are there at the facility. Third lesson. We've been thinking a lot in recent years about messaging. One of the things that became very clear from the situation in Japan is that one message related to evacuation or sheltering does not fit all. And that is because of very differing assessments of risk and very different assessments of the costs associated with evacuation. What we saw was that families with children self-evacuated very early on, whether they were asked to or told to or not. So they essentially fled from areas that were ultimately evacuated as well as from areas that were not needing evacuation. On the other hand, families with farms, families with businesses in affected areas were highly resistant to leaving. And indeed, they were concerned about their farm animals being slaughtered out, which, by the way, they ultimately were. Businesses were concerned about looting and physical security. And then older people, we saw, were extremely resistant to leaving. And indeed, you'll see this brief article. This is just one person. It's an extreme example, but it's about a 102-year-old man who was told he had to evacuate and preferred to commit suicide rather than leave the area that was familiar to him and the place that he knew so well. So, lesson number three, we already have a hard job with messaging in general. What the accident at Fukushima Daiichi shows us is that one size is not going to fit all when it comes to evacuation or sheltering. Lesson number four, and I'm wrapping up. I just have two more slides. This one and the next one. Lesson number four, stigma. We see stigma after every major radiological or nuclear incident. We saw it after Chernobyl. We saw it after the 1987 accident in Brazil at Goiânia. We saw it after the 1999 incident in Japan at Tokaimura. Indeed, it has reared its ugly head again in the case of Fukushima Daiichi. And it is not surprising. Let me start by saying that in facing this disaster, the Japanese people have showed incredible courage. There is enormous, enormous helping behavior. People have been as welcoming as humanly possible to those coming to their areas. So I want to start by saying that that is something that we have seen a huge amount of, helping behavior. More than 100,000 people from other parts of Japan have volunteered to go to the affected areas to render assistance. That being said, alongside that, we have seen fear of radiation and fear of radioactive contamination translate into a whole host of manifestations of stigma. This includes fruits and vegetables and other agricultural products that are in areas that are safe and uncontaminated, but people in other parts of the country still don't want to buy them. It has involved, you see an example here, where 80% of the approximately 125 elementary schools from another prefecture that were scheduled to go to a part of Fukushima Prefecture that is clean, nevertheless canceled. And there have been examples where people have personally been affected, whether it is cars that have Fukushima area license plates being targeted with hostility, graffiti, or things of that sort. So lesson number four is that stigma is a major challenge in these situations. It essentially causes a secondary social and economic disaster and heaps that on top of everything else that has been experienced. And we need to have a more systematic approach to preventing it and, when it occurs, to dealing with it. Lastly, regardless of what official policy may be, screening certificates become central in people's lives in these sorts of situations. Some of you who are familiar with the 1987 Goiani accident in Brazil probably recall or have read that there, because of the stigma being so powerful, people who went through radiation screening had to have certificates to be able to get on airplanes, to be able to check into a hotel. They had to have physical proof in the form of a piece of paper that said that they were clean. Otherwise, they encountered discrimination. In the case of Fukushima Daiichi, the central government had a very clear policy. We are not going to do this. We expect evacuation centers not to demand certificates from people, and we expect no one to demand certificates. What happened on the ground, however, was entirely different. In fact, evacuation centers did demand certificates that people were clean. Other facilities demanded certificates from people. And so this became something where ultimately at the prefectural level, the governments decided to go along with it and to make it an official process where they actually issued certificates to everyone who was screened, put an official seal on them so that people could go to hotels, they could travel to other areas, and they could go into shelters without either being discriminated against, turned away, or alarming people who were already in there. This is a big issue, and it will be a big challenge in any large-scale radiological event. How do we handle this? What is our policy going to be? It is something that needs to be worked out in advance. It needs to be part and parcel of our strategy for dealing with whether it's an IND event or another large event. And if we are going to use these certificates to certify that people are clean, what goes on them? Is it just information about the screening? Or, for example, do we include where people who have had the screening can go for further information should they have questions about their own results? So this, I think, poses a major policy issue for us, and it needs to be grappled with in our planning in advance. And with that, I'm going to be quiet and sit down. So, thank you.
All right, thank you very much. I want to, given the time, I want to briefly speak with you about how the Fukushima incident looked from the perspective of the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, and what our response was during this event, and what the event has taught us about preparedness for a comparable incident here in the United States. And I'm not going to be able to represent the entire spectrum of activities of the United States government, but as you hear my talk, you'll hear a lot about partnerships with other U.S. government agencies. It really was a whole of government response, and anyone who doubts that when Brian Kamoy speaks here in the next session should ask him how many interagency meetings he attended in the White House. We activated our Emergency Operations Center, I believe, the day after the earthquake occurred. I think many of you probably subscribe to the same U.S. Geological Survey service that I do that sends you an email anytime there's an earthquake somewhere in the world. And it usually turns out to be of little consequence. This was not one of those times, clearly. And the initial question as we saw the unfolding radiological disaster was, we knew that there would be radionuclides detected here in the United States. We know this has happened after every above-ground nuclear test. It happened after Chernobyl. Once we knew that radionuclides were released at Fukushima, it seemed inevitable that they would be detected here. The only question was how much, how would we know, and would it be at a level that would require any kind of public health or health interventions? And in this case, we relied very heavily on what they called plausible worst case modeling efforts that were conducted by Department of Energy agencies, which indicated that even if you had significant loss of the radiologic sources at Fukushima, with aerosolization of 40% of the fuel in several of the reactors, that the amount that would make it across the Pacific to the United States was very unlikely to be enough to mount to result in health effects here. And obviously, we haven't seen anything quite that severe. So based on that information and based on the radiological monitoring that was done, we were able to assess that there really was not a need for anyone in the United States to be taking potassium iodide. So it meant that our response was primarily to ensure that there was appropriate monitoring done in the United States, that we were informing the public of everything we knew, and that we were ensuring that the data were available, and conducting a significant both public health and public educational outreach. The government of Japan decided that they were able to handle the humanitarian aspects of the response to the tsunami and the earthquake. So unlike our response to the Asian tsunami disaster in 2004, we did not mount a major humanitarian response. We did send a few responders to Japan to help with the radiological issues, both to work with the government of Japan and to work with the Department of State and the U.S. Embassy, because there were something like 300,000 Americans in Japan at the time, including military personnel, DOD dependents, State Department employees, and private citizens. And we needed to be sure that they were being provided sufficient guidance so that they would understand what was going on and know what they needed to do to care for themselves and to how to respond if there was a deterioration of any sort. We had a lot of interagency partners here. I want to particularly give a shout out to the Environmental Protection Agency. EPA maintains a radiologic monitoring system called RadNet. It actually was created during the era of Cold War above ground nuclear testing and has endured with refinements to this day. RadNet conducts testing of air levels of radionuclides, radionuclide detection in surface water, particularly water that's been deposited by rain, and also testing of milk. And before this incident started, getting access to RadNet data was a bit of a challenge. It was behind a firewall that required registration and adoption of a password, and very quickly EPA moved it outside that firewall, made the displays more user-friendly, and really turned it into a resource for the media and for the public. And in terms of an interagency process, my colleagues in the Emergency Operations Center there diligently gave us a heads up every time they were about to release another bolus of RadNet monitoring data, so that we at USDA, FDA, and CDC were prepared in case questions would come up. I regard this as one of the successes. FDA and USDA likewise had to collaborate on questions about food safety, and you have to really sympathize for them. They're still dealing with questions about seafood safety from Deepwater Horizon, and so I guess one of the positive aspects of that was that the precedent for that kind of interagency collaboration had been established, gave them something to build on. Nonetheless, they had to meet that challenge as well. Another interagency partner we had to work with was Department of Homeland Security's Customs and Border Patrol, because there were questions about potential for radionuclide contamination among travelers coming from Japan to the United States. So CDC's people who normally work on infectious disease screening at the borders ended up working with the radiation experts as well as CBP to come up with a monitoring strategy for assessing contamination of passengers coming in from Japan. Fortunately, we found very few. I think we had two travelers who were headed for South America that just transited through the United States. They set off some radiation pagers, but were deemed not to have significant levels of contamination. And there was one traveler whose destination was in CONUS who exceeded the threshold that we had set, and we had a policy in place there that those travelers would be referred to their state radiation control officers, and that guy was met at his home by the state, by representative from that state's program, and after several showers and I think trimming his beard, his radiation levels were down to, you know, one or two times normal background, so he was cleared. There was also screening of luggage, and again, we fortunately had very few with detected contamination. Another area of interagency collaboration was on the question of screening cargo coming in from Japan, and this was a real concern initially by the Longshoremen's Union, which approached OSHA to ask whether they were at risk for handling cargo from Japan that might have been contaminated. And then also from the Department of Transportation, which regulates the interstate movement of cargo. And so before it was done, we had collaboration again with DHS CBP, the DHS Office of the Assistant Secretary for Health, and Kathy Brinsfield, who is in here, was one of the primary actors in that group, Department of Transportation, OSHA, and CDC's National Institute for Occupational Safety and Health, NIOSH. We came up with a standard for what was the allowable limit. Actually, I don't believe there was any detection of cargo that exceeded that limit, so it was turned out to be not to be an issue. We worked a lot on providing health guidance, both to the public, as well as to the public health community, and to clinicians. A lot of information on our website having to do with understanding food and water safety, understanding some of the key radionuclides of concern, mainly iodine-131 and cesium-137, producing fact sheets on all these topics, and working with some of these other agencies to ensure that our public communications were in harmony. We had conference calls with state health departments working through the auspices of the Association of State and Territorial Health Officers, ASTHO, and the National Association of County and City Health Officers, NACHO, as well as existing frameworks we have for reaching out to clinical organizations, our so-called clinicians' calls. We use the CDC webpage, we use social media, including Twitter and Facebook, we were gratified to discover that there were significant hits on our webpage actually coming from Japan. Our information was seen as being so valuable that, we know they were coming from Japan. We assume that many of those were American citizens. May have been, some were Japanese as well. So we're glad people found it useful. The challenges that we had in this response were several. One in particular, and which Steve touched on, it was the challenge of bringing health responders in all disciplines up to speed. Health responders tend not to be familiar with radiation issues. Even in the public health community, we have a lot of experience with infectious diseases. I think that's what a lot of people go into public health to work on, not so much on radiological issues. The challenge of rapid public communication. It's not just good enough to tell people what we think they need to know, but we have to do it in a timely fashion, and sometimes that becomes a challenge. And in this case, there were many things that were unfamiliar concepts that people in radiological response take for granted. The whole issue of time, exposure, distance, different types of radionuclides, the different types of radiation. I mentioned the importance of communication between the different federal agencies who were responding. We did this with conference calls, with emails. Brian and his colleagues at the White House fostered it at their level. We even reached out directly between EOCs and ultimately, in some cases, sent liaison officers. This was the first time CDC sent a liaison to the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, and it turned out to be one of the great things that we did. And I want to close, given our limited time, with what we learned and some of the needs that we identified. I've touched on the need for radiation education and awareness among the health community. I think we really learned about the importance of dealing with what I call the movement of the four Ps: people, pets, products, and produce. And if you think that was an issue for us dealing with people coming, with all four of those coming from Japan, think about what it'll be like for us if we have to deal with intra or interstate movement of those four items in the after a domestic incident. We saw the Japanese mount an incredible response to deal with population monitoring. I frankly stand in awe of it, and I know that this remains a gap in our own national preparedness. As I think we've already heard today, there is a need to revisit questions about potassium iodide stockpiling in the United States. Not only how much, but also where. Right now, our strategy is that potassium iodide is given to the state where a regulated nuclear power plant exists, and it's up to the state to either stock it or dispense it as they deem appropriate according to their plans. We've always felt that there wasn't much point in putting potassium iodide in the strategic national stockpile because we expected a nuclear emergency would occur so quickly there would be no time to ship it for use in the short time window, a couple hours on either side of the exposure in which it must be used. In Fukushima, we see an example of an incident in which, you know, pardon the expression, it was a slow-moving train wreck. The incident occurred, and there was lots of time afterwards to worry about when a release might occur. There might, in fact, have been, if this were a U.S. situation, there might, in fact, be a time frame in which you could move potassium iodide from a central repository into the affected area. So that's something for us to revisit. Likewise, revisiting planning assumptions about how far away is the area that will be affected by one of these incidents, and the use of social media. A number of people have talked about social media today, and only one of them has talked about, most of them have talked about social media as a means of pushing information out. Only one person has talked about using it as a means of pulling information in, gaining situational awareness through the power of what some people call crowdsourcing. This is going to be another one of those instances where we'll want as much information as we can get as we manage our response. And finally, I want to talk about shortage of subject matter experts. You know, when we were thinking about how to prepare for bioterrorism, we have the advantage that there are a lot of infectious disease specialists in the United States. When we think about radiological disasters, there are not a lot of radiation experts. And the community of health physicists, quite frankly, is shrinking because many of them were trained in an era when federal funds supported health physicist training as a means of preparing people to go out into what at that time was expected to be the growing nuclear power industry. That's not true anymore, and we need to think about how we're going to feed that pipeline if we're going to maintain national preparedness. I'll close with those with that comment and turn to our last.
Thank you very much. The White House says we have about 10 more minutes.
Is Brian here?
He is.
All right. Well, hi, I'm Michael Gresalfi. I'm in the unenviable position of having 1 minute and 22 seconds on the clock. And you think that's a problem. I've got both Brian Kamoy and Admiral Kroll starting to stack rotten tomatoes in front of them. So I will be brief. Yeah, thank you very much. Thank you. Well, I think I'll set the tone at least a bit for Brian's more lengthy discussion to follow. Let me first say, in my less than 10 minutes, I'm going to first entice you to look inside of your folders where you will see two things that I have placed there. One is a fact sheet, a single sheet, double-sided fact sheet on whole community approach. And it encourages you as a reader and engaged participant to respond back to us. We have a dedicated email and we've got some questions. Secondly, there's a 6-slide briefing in there that is just a very pithy taste of this whole community effort. I'm going to spend 3 minutes talking about it, and then I'm going to share my senior advisor perspectives on lessons learned we might derive in FEMA across our whole community initiative from the Japanese event. First, whole community, what is it? I'm not saying it's, am I having a problem here? He's taking away this one. All right. 3 seconds and counting. All right, so whole community, what do we mean? Our administrator, Craig Fugate, and his entire senior leadership team came out of the practice. They managed state and regional emergency management efforts for decades. They have found over time that when a catastrophe is large enough, we're incapable of responding effectively. We cannot scale up fast enough, deep enough, wide enough to save and sustain the people we want to save and sustain, which is everybody in the impacted area, and stabilize the event. So this whole community initiative was about a year ago, a legacy that Craig and team would like to leave behind. One thing I will do is ask my friend here to pass me the briefing, because I'm going to just quickly show you a few things that are already in your package. One thing I would ask you to think about is look at our brand new strategic plan. The FEMA strategic plan, dated February of this year, came out in March, is completely steeped in this philosophy of whole community, and it will give you a much more broad perspective on what we're attempting to do. If I had you look at anything in these five slides, it would be those three boxes, and I'm not going to speak directly to them. I'm going to speak around them briefly. First of all, we can't possibly save and sustain the lives in these impacted zones following what we call a meta disaster unless we are engaging all of society in the impact region itself, as well as in the area right outside the region. We can't get there fast enough. We can't get there deep enough. It's a fact. So what we're doing in this whole community is something that we were doing years and years ago during the civil defense era, is bringing in and asking to participate all facets of our society. And I mean areas that we haven't really delved deeply, including social and fraternal organizations, both at the national level as well as at the state and local town level. Groups like the VFW and the American Legion and the PTA, and you can keep going on. One of the things that makes our democracy so special, in my opinion, is how much civic engagement we have. It's a discriminator, I believe, compared to most other democracies. And we have an immense fabric of capacity here, volunteer forces. I will just share with you a vignette. Having myself been a post commander of the American Legion, went to National American Legion and spoke with them ostensibly about the concept of them reaching through the millions of vets that are members of posts, seeing if they might be willing to go through some traffic management training where they would buy their own little orange vests and their own little coned lights and go through some training so that they could reach out themselves at the post town level to their local police and sheriff and let them know if you ever have an event and you need us to help you with traffic management so you can focus on other things, we'll be there. We just heard from Steve, one of the issues coming out of Fukushima was traffic management. I'm not saying this would have helped in Japan, but the concept of really engaging more deeply all of our society, and that includes faith-based organizations, NGOs, and all of private industry, not the traditional ones. So we're embarking on this effort. And again, very briefly, I'm going to share with you where we created. We started with this meta scenario. And why I want to start here and then go into lessons learned is I don't look at this as a Fukushima event. I know that's your topic. I don't. I look at it as an immense cascading catastrophe, primarily an earthquake and a tsunami where almost all of the death and mayhem was caused. And then a little bit where all the press and politicians like to focus on, which is Fukushima. This is Michael Gresalfi speaking, not the administrator. But if we were to focus on where the greatest attention needs to be on saving and sustaining lives, sometimes I do get concerned that we tend to follow where the media takes us. And I have to tell you personally, I'm a little bit concerned that even in Japan, as we start to reflect deeply, I would challenge, would we have seen all the resources, domestic as well as international, most appropriately focused based on saving and sustaining lives and stabilizing that event? Or were they swayed to some amount by all of the attention that we focused on what I would see as a relatively small event based on the lives lost and the damage to society? Okay, just to set the tone. Now, moving on to lessons learned from the Gresalfi perspective, recognize FEMA was a support agency during this event. So we had no direct role. We supported whoever asked of us, EPA, the State Department, lots of folks in this room. So again, from my perspective, what I would be looking for from a whole community intersection with the Japanese event is interdependencies that we didn't think about and how they affect both our outcomes that we planned on and the resiliency that we're all hoping to achieve. There's so many and they're so deep, and I would hope all of us are challenged to look inside this Japanese event. I will start with the psychosocial briefly, since that's what Joe said. Again, from my perspective, first of all, we talked about aftershocks. Generally, every 3 hours since the main event, there's been an aftershock of a 5.0 or higher. Every 3 hours, they expect that to last for a year or more. And some folks in the room know where I got that data. Thank you very much. Some of the preliminary evidence shows the effects, the psychosocial effects, not just on the people, but on the entire nation. So of course, we all would expect sleep deprivation, REM-related issues. There's been a great increase in anxiety disorders, sleep disorders, et cetera. And they're not just psychosocial, they affect every other element of our ability to respond, recover, and to bounce back. And so I would challenge all of us to think about this not as a singular event, but an ongoing event, and how does that change our ability to meet our planned objectives? I would say a great deal. Secondly, look at some of the population movements since the event. Because of many reasons, clearly the fear and stigma that we heard about with radiation, but I would posit even more so, this continuation of aftershocks. In Tokyo alone, again from a source in this room, about 1 million folks out of 20 million have basically departed Tokyo since that event. 80% plus foreign companies and their foreign staff. The other 20%, senior leaders and managers in the Japanese market and their wives and children. Just think about the long-term permutations that causes to the ability to continue on as a society functioning on all levels. Secondly, political governmental drivers. The key to whole community is that we need to re-engage fully the small towns, the small cities, the larger cities, the regions, in understanding what capacity they have in and around their region, city, town, and how to tap into them when they plan and respond and recover to an event. All right, so let's think about the Japanese as a study, a great country, very centralized government. I would posit that if we did some additional investigation, we would see a lot of challenges that they faced because of the extreme power in a central government, not a lot of relationships strong in all prefectures to the central government, and particularly looking at cities like Sendai and Miyagi and the mayorials and what they've been trying to do, the leadership, they have challenges in the typical world pushing what they think are the highest priorities up the chain of prefectures and central government. Again, anecdotal that these mayors in some areas have been pushing back and have been really stretching what they consider their authority and being a lot more proactive than you would have seen in the past. So I would challenge us to be looking at things like that. Finally, I don't want to run out of time. Fatality management is a big issue, and it relates to not just being respectful of the dead and recognizing cultural mores, but Craig Fugate, our leader, makes it very clear when we look at our most essential functions to save and sustain lives during those first few days, that don't forget stabilizing that event. And when we say stabilization, we're talking about ensuring you don't lose the heart and the mind of the people, and that the press doesn't start to attack you all the time, and that because of all of this, the politicians start to question your plans going forward. Saying that, there were a lot of complexities on fatality management that we can learn from the overall Japanese event. The fact that we have 28, 29,000 people dead, the fact that the cultural mores of Japan really demand that you try to retrieve the body, there are today 25,000 soldiers still looking for bodies, and there's a huge, naval sea operation that's extended 20 miles offshore looking for bodies. This is a huge issue, and it's something that we should be taking and looking within our own societal mores, how we think we should be better prepared to deal with that. Secondly, pets and livestock. We heard a little bit about pets. First, you might have read this. It's through all the press. There have been what I would call these intervener groups or these well-meaning volunteer groups that have been sneaking back into radiation zones to retrieve stray dogs and stray cats, you know, putting themselves at danger. You know, you can look at this two ways. One of them is, well, you know, that's their choice. Or the other is, we need to do a better job at figuring out how to deal with stray animals. And there's a whole range of things that we need to think about. On that same line, livestock, at least from my read, there's been more than 1 million chickens and 150,000 pigs and 3,000 or 4,000 cows that died in place directly or indirectly, which we should be thinking about in terms of, do you triage, which ones do you transport, do you euthanize in mass more effectively? And remember now, those effects have interdependencies between all of them that I mentioned. And it's not just psychosocial, there's market things, there's cultural mores, there's political drivers, and I think we all need to do a better job. And finally, I would just reflect on the fact, again, that I think we need to always focus when it comes to these complex disasters on where do we need to focus our resources, attentions as much as possible. It's on the saving of lives, sustaining lives, stabilizing the event, and trying to not allow sometimes the fears and stigmas that we've heard about drive decision making that might take us other places. That's my story. Bye.
And thank you very much, Mike.